Listen, I heard that TJ was acting like how we used to do like 20, 30 years ago in the old Pentecostal church. He's just running around during the beginning of worship. Listen, 20, 30 years ago, none of us would have batted an eye if they would have saw somebody running around in the congregation. They would have started running. All of a sudden, they would have... So, I brought him out to the side, and I was like, dude, do we do that during music? And he's like, no. I was like, okay, let's take a walk. We're really glad that children are children. We can teach them how to be able to grow up in church. You know, we don't have to worry about laying hands in the wrong way. If you have your Bibles this morning, why don't you turn with me to the book of Genesis? We're going to be all through chapter 16 this morning. And the great thing that my son did for me is that he basically rewrote my intro with a great illustration. How many times do moms and dads try or attempt to bring their kids in to do adult things that don't turn out the way that we expect? You know, we look at the photo of kids helping out with dishes and helping out with recipes. We all know that the photo is only a certain thing. Behind there's probably tons of flour and dirty dishes, and everything is all over the place. In fact, one of the people that I follow on social media is a grandmother, and she started teaching her 3- and 4-year-old grandson to be able to do recipes with her. And every time that she put a stick of butter or a little bit of sugar, he had to, just by happenstance, had to put his hand in there and pull it out and try to grab and eat it. And all of a sudden, the aftermath of everything, she's trying to grab his hand before destruction could be able to happen. But kids make a mess, right? And kids also attempt to help their parents clean up the mess and make an even bigger mess of things sometimes. We all know that. Now, let me ask you this question. Do we ever help our Heavenly Father with solutions that we might have and make a mess? All the time. There are times, too many times in this Christian walk, where we see what the Father has done, victory over victory over victory, and what we try to do is imitate those things. And sometimes everything works out great. Yeah, I've seen Dad do this, so if I do it, it'll work out. But sometimes we'll offer the same solution to a different situation, and the worst results come out of it. Because we didn't talk to God and fill him in and ask him what the next steps should be. I do this with my kids all the time. When I go and I reach out to them in love, I mean, we would say that it's wrath, not love, and discipline them. Sometimes not explaining myself, or sometimes not being patient and saying, hey, take a few minutes, because I need to take a few minutes and pray to God of what I need to do next, because I want to treat you guys like Sodom. No parent has done that. I love how they're all quiet now. Listen, okay, I heard it from my grandmother. She caught amnesia after 30 years of not having my mom in the house, and she said, I never put my hands on you. Lies. What I'm trying to get at here is that sometimes we try to help God execute his plan. We try to speed up the process, or we try to take a different route. Anybody have a GPS? When you see the traffic that is on the Garden State Parkway or on I-95, you try to use your Waze app to redirect you, and all of a sudden you're in a neighborhood that you've never seen before, but it's okay, you saved 2 minutes. The story that we're going to talk about today is about Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar, and how they try to cook up a solution that God didn't plan. That they tried to help their Heavenly Father in the next part of the plan because they thought that they had the solution or the target in mind. And because of that, it messed things up. But luckily, with this entire chapter, you can take this home. The Lord transforms our solutions into blessings. Would you bow your heads and hearts with me in a word of prayer? Father God, we come before you in the name of Jesus, and we thank you for everything that you have done in this room. You have met us, O God. And we're so appreciative because sometimes we know that your presence is here, but we don't feel it. Sometimes we want to hear your voice, but it feels so far off, God. Thank you for answering your children this morning. We ask that you deliver this message in the best way possible and give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and more importantly, hands and feet to respond to the word. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We've been in Genesis for a few weeks now, and we just got done with a conversation that God had with Abram. He answered him and answered the question of having an heir and the question of having the land. God says in this conversation, you will have a child by your own seed. It will not be an adoption clause or anything like that. Nobody's going to have to worry about taking care of you outside of your family. Your family name will live through. And then God cuts a covenant with Abram in speaking about the land, and he gives him a little bit of a foreshadow of what's going to happen, how his descendants are going to have to go to a faraway land and learn to be just as dependent on God as he has been throughout this journey. So far, everything is good. Abram has been doing great. Yeah, he's slipped up a few times, but nothing that anybody can't fix. But then all of a sudden, the next chapter comes a test. How many people know anytime that you have a transformative experience with God, there's a test right next to it? Every time. You see it in scripture and you see it in life. The gentleman just went to a men's conference yesterday, and I guarantee you when they got home, the first thing that they got was a test. I just had this great experience with God. And then our spouses will say something that doesn't mean to be disrespectful. They're just saying a fact, but that's how we interpreted it. Any husbands in the room like that? Any husbands in the room actually do that? Say something after their spouse comes home. Where have you been? They say it just like that. Ooh. There are more husbands that have egg on their face during that time than wives. So, getting back into the word, what's going to happen now in this test is that Abraham is going to be getting some advice or a possible solution from his wife. Well, that's his partner. It's a person that he should trust the most. But should you be trusting a partner more than you should be trusting God? No. God had not filled in the details of what was going to happen yet. And as much as we love our partners, our friends, our mentors, if it didn't come from God first, we wait. We don't do. Amen? So, let's get into it. The Lord transforms our solutions into blessings. And the first thing that our solutions do, we have to come to this reality, our solutions bring failure. Genesis 16, starting in verse 1. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. We're back to the problem again. But she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, "The Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her." Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar and she conceived. When she knew that she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "You are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my slave in your arms, and now that she knows that she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me." This doesn't sound like a sermon. This sounds like any other night in any other house. Any house. Let me tell you something. Saved or unsaved, people messy. Immediately the blame game happens. Okay? Remember, Sarai doesn't start blaming Abram. The first person that she blames is God. The first person that she blames is God. The Lord has kept me from having kids. Now, you need to understand, barrenness is the most significant thing that could happen to a woman in the ancient Near East. To not be able to be fruitful and multiply was to be as good as gone and non-existent. Culturally, she was nothing, or more insignificant than nothing. People looked at barrenness worse than slavery back then. You need to understand this to understand why she is pleading this way. But then she has this bright idea, this great idea. Go sleep with my slave, and perhaps I can have a family through her. Can we just pause and how absurd does that sound to us? But where they were at, that wasn't crazy at all. In fact, if a wife and a husband could not have children, there were three possible solutions that you could be able to have back then. One was divorce and remarry. You can get divorced after you knew that your wife was past the conception age of having children and remarry, hopefully to somebody who would produce a child. Sounds like King Henry VIII. The next one was polygamy, having multiple wives of equal status, and through them you could be able to bear your seed and live about your name. But the last one, which is the solution that they used, was very familiar to the culture, which was surrogacy through a handmaiden or a slave. The theory was that Hagar's child would not be her child at all, but that she would bear him and that Sarai would raise the child as her own. But the problem was, and the problem here is, where is God in all of this? Nobody went, "Hey, can you help us out? Can we get some clarity here?" No, nothing happened in that way. The one time that Abram hasn't inquired of the Lord yet, or the second time, we'll bring up the first time as we're going through this story. He doesn't inquire of God at all. He just says, "Sounds good." That sounds like a man. "Yes, dear." Bang. I can say it. I'm a man. I understand. But the bright idea that they both say yes to, you know what it brings? It does bring polygamy, which is unbiblical, because God put one man and one woman together. It brings heartache. You know, Genesis 3, when talking about the heartache that the woman had to suffer, it's not just about childbearing. But if you look at the text, it is not just bearing a child or giving birth, it is raising children. And that prophecy is literally fulfilled in this part. Through the raising of this child, there's going to come hardship and heartache and sadness and hurt and anger and strife between the family. How is any of this going to be blessed by God? Their solution brought failure even before the baby was even born. Now, how does this apply to you and me today? Well, church, we got some really bright ideas. Oh, everybody got quiet now. We have some really bright ideas. Heck, we're the generation that brings you things like ShamWow and OxyClean. But wait, there's more. We have bright ideas all the time. And what we do is that we put our bright ideas and we say, well, it looks biblical, it sounds biblical, so maybe I can be able to insert it without talking to God, without bringing it to him in prayer. Maybe I can be able to act on it and he will bless it after the fact. That's not how God works. Last time I checked, it doesn't say God goes behind us. It says that God goes before us. So if that is the case, the only thing that we're going to produce is sin. You know, sin, yes, is missing the mark and doing wrong. That is a definition of sin. But this is what you also need to understand. God created the entire world to be good, some way, shape, or form. When we, no matter Christian or non-Christian, abuse the good thing that God has given to us, it is also sin. So, music is great, but what they play on half the radio stations is abuse of the good thing that God has made. The internet is great, but the industries that have manipulated the internet have sinned against the Lord. God wants to partner with us to make followers of Christ. However, if we're making those disciples and we're compromising his word, his holiness, and his priorities, we have sinned. Thank you for all those amens. It's a hard truth to be able to swallow. But if we have to talk about the full counsel of God, we have to be convicted as much as we feel good, right? Let's be reminded of the words of Jesus when he said this to Simon Peter. He said this, and I tell you, Peter, Jesus asked a question. Hey, boys, he's talking to the 12. What do everybody say I am? Who does everybody say that I am? You know, some people say that you're a prophet. Some people that you say that you're Elijah. Some people that you say you're a good, holy, teaching man. But what do you guys say? And Peter says, you're the Christ, the anointed one, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, I tell you that you are Peter. And on this rock, on the statement that you said, Peter, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not overcome it. But right after, the next story, as Jesus turns to Jerusalem and tells them that he is going to be persecuted and die, Peter starts rebuking him. He says, no, Lord, that's not a part of the plan. You're supposed to be a king. You're supposed to be elevated. You're supposed to dominate this entire thing. And in Luke 6:23, Jesus turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, because you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Peter, a disciple, the disciple who gave the sermon at Pentecost, who studied under Jesus for years, attempt to bring his own solution, which would have brought failure to all mankind. Christ had to go to Jerusalem. Christ had to die to forgive the sins of the world. And I am happy that in his most vulnerable state, in a garden with nothing but the enemy whispering into his ear, the Lord raised up his hands and said, not my will, but yours be done. In fact, the psalmist often speaks about the solutions of God and how he holds the whole universe in the palm of his hand, perfectly balanced. One scientist said it like this: if anything in the cosmos had one calculation off of it, one, an inch less than or an inch more, the entire thing would collapse. How great God is. And in Psalm 36, starting in verse 5, this is what it says. It's not going to be on the screen. It says, your loving kindness, O Lord, extends to the heavens. says, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mountain and holy hill of God. Your judgment is like the great deep. O Lord, you preserve man and animal. The Lord, his wisdom and his greatness, has placed balance in all of creation. And we truly believe that I need to help him out because he might be too busy. Maybe you just need to be still and know that he is God. I don't know what happened to me this morning, apparently. I feel a little riled up. It's probably the lavalier. I don't have anything in my hand. Let's accept the fact that apart from the Lord, we can do nothing except temporary things. But let's believe God for the solutions that will be eternal, the great and mighty things. Will you believe that with this morning? So, our solutions produce failure. They bring failure. This is the next thing that it does. You know, I'll make you feel bad a little bit more. Our solutions produce injustice. Genesis 16, starting in verse 5. Then Sarai said to Abram, you are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my slave in your arms, and now that she knows she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me. Your slave is in your hands, Abram said. Do whatever you think is best. Then Sarai mistreated Hagar, so she fled from her. That was a great idea, wasn't it? Abram, go sleep with my maid. Yes, ma'am. You got it. What do we got to lose? Everything. Everything. Remember whose bright idea this was. It was Sarai's, and yet she not only blames God, but she blames her husband afterwards. The story reminds me of a mixed up version of Genesis 3. Think about this. Eve took the fruit and gave it to her husband. Sarai took Hagar and gave her to her husband. Then, when the solution goes south, or let me put it this way, when the wisdom she thought that she had was actually sin, who does she blame? Her spouse. Like Adam and Eve. There's so much injustice in this passage. First of all, you're dealing with slavery. God does not permit slavery. In fact, we've been going through our Wednesday night Bible study. Every 7 years after he committed his covenant with Israel, he freed people of slavery and debt slavery. He wanted to meet people where they were at in their certain situations, and we understand that it takes sometimes a lifetime to understand those things and to recognize those injustices because of the time of the day. But God was never for slavery. In fact, not only was slavery permitted, but this woman, against her will, was forced to be married and sleep with a man that was her husband. She didn't have a choice. She couldn't divorce, or she couldn't run away without being persecuted or killed. And then she did something wrong too. She got too big for her britches. And she started bad-mouthing the person who literally has her life in her hands. And that person is now mistreating her to the point where she is in tears, broken, and running away. Here's the kicker. This injustice, this was a solution coming from the family chosen by God. This wasn't evil people. This wasn't Sodom and Gomorrah or the Tower of Babel. This wasn't the people inside Jericho. These were God's chosen partners. And yet they thought that this was a great idea. Our solutions produce injustice. Another story that this reminds me of is the story of David and Bathsheba. Now, for those of you who might not know that story, King David, he's always known as a man after God's own heart. Great man of faith, wonderful man. He is proud, he is able to be able to conquer, and he's a man of war that has brought victory for God and victory for the kingdom of Israel. And once he becomes king a few years into it, he doesn't go off to war with the rest of his soldiers. What he does is that he stays home and he catches a woman showering. And he tells his guard, do me a favor, go bring her to me. Doesn't ask questions. He goes and he has an affair with her and she becomes pregnant. And then he gets her husband to try to come home and sleep with her. But the husband has too much integrity. And he understands that his fellow soldiers are now out in the field dying. And he doesn't want to dine with the king. He doesn't want to go home and sleep with his wife and relax because he understands he still has a mission to go on. Uriah was such a better man of God than David in this situation. And what does David do? David says, hey, do me a favor. Go back to the war and everything like that. Bring Joab, the commander, this decree. He says, put Uriah as close to the front lines as possible. And then, so much to the point where there is going to be death that happens. And then do me a favor, just retreat. That's what he says. And then when the messenger comes back after that has been accomplished, this is what David says in 2 Samuel 11:25. Say this to Joab. Don't let this upset you. The sword devours one as well as another. Press the attack against the city and destroy it. Say this to encourage Joab. Verse 26. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. And after the time of mourning was over, David brought her to his house. And she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. Wait a minute. Boaz, do we have that picture in there right after this? This is what's happening. But wait a minute. This is the situation that is happening. Isn't this the same dude who killed a giant? Isn't this the same guy who said that the Lord would be the only one to bring me victory? At 17 years old, he had more faith than what he did right now. He did something wrong, and he tried to fix it, and murder is now on his hands. It doesn't matter if you are in the family of God or if you're out of the family of God. If you try to fix it yourself, it will only produce injustice. How many things have happened in the name of religion or in the name of faith? How many? I'll give you one of them. In fact, I'll give you two. One of them was the Crusades. The Crusades, literally, as one of the popes was passing away, he talked about taking back over the Holy Land, and thousands of men marched to and through what we would call modern-day Turkey to get to Jerusalem, and thousands of innocent people lost their life. Men, women, and children were slaughtered in the name of taking back the Holy Land for our God. Because what they said was, these preachers, these priests didn't go back to the word of God. They said, if you help take it back, we'll give you absolution. That means we'll clear you of your sins, any blood that you shed, because you're doing this for the mission of God. God didn't tell them to do that. That was no power of the Holy Spirit. Yet they did it, and there are millions of people probably now that are not in this world because their ancestors were slaughtered in the name of religion and faith. And people look at me and they say, well, Pastor, thank God that we're so far away from that, that we don't produce injustices like that on a mass scale. Really? I'll give you another one. How about the Holocaust? The Holocaust, while Hitler was transporting Jews to the concentration camps, it split the church in half. The church was split in half because half of them loved their country and God as much as they loved their religion. And the church split, and you had half of the people saying Hitler is doing a good thing because they are ridding the old people who did not believe in God. And the other half was led by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who understood that every single human life was precious, so much so that he gave up his life to make sure that the church was saving every person possible. Because this was a solution produced by a human, not God. And look at the aftermath of all of it. Our world is more broken now than ever before because we hear wars and rumors of wars. And we look to, I'm sorry, I'm going to offend somebody. We look to political ideology rather than the word of God. I don't bleed red and I don't bleed blue. I preach, teach, and submit myself to the doctrine of my Lord. And what my Lord has said to me is that every single human life is precious. It is not my job to try to fix it. It is my job to bow down to the person that can. Let us keep our eyes on Jesus, as it says in Hebrews 12:2. Because according to this word, he is the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. So let's get our solution from the head so that we can continue to be the head and not the tail. But our solutions mess things up, guys. But remember what our main point is. Remember, it's the Lord transforms our solutions into blessings. And this is what God does. This is how great he is. The Lord works out our mistakes. The Lord works out our mistakes. Because look at this. In 16, starting in verse 7, the angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that is beside the road to Shur. So she's running to Egypt, just FYI. Shur is on the way to go back down to Egypt. She's running home because even as a slave, she feels like she is safer down in her own country. And the angel said, Hagar, slave of Sarai, where have you come from? Where are you going? I'm running away from my mistress Sarai, she answered. And then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. The angel added, I will increase your descendants so much that they will be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord said to her, you are now pregnant and you will give birth to a son, and you shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard of your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand will be against him. He will live in hostility towards all of his brothers. With all the injustice and unfairness of the world, blessed be the Lord, who is righteous and just. Because He pursues Hagar. He comforts her. He hears her pain. Reminder, this woman is not the chosen one. This woman that doesn't have the covenant promises, she has not received the same blessings that Abraham and Sarah had. Yet, when being mistreated, when being hurt, and when being broken, God pursues all. This would be the last person that we would think of to God to reach out to. Yet in his mercy, he visits Hagar and begins to introduce himself to her because his solutions work out our mistakes. The Lord gives Hagar the child with the same blessing as the promised child that Abram will have in a few chapters from now. His descendants will increase. They will become too numerous to count. When God makes a promise, he keeps it. Just because this child comes in unintended circumstances doesn't mean that he is less worthy to receive the blessing. I've heard it said many times, there might be something as accidental parents in our eyes, but there's no such thing as accidental children. Every child that comes in this world has been knit and molded by God. Remember, here is something that we have to remember, though. This is something for you and me as well. Is that when we make a decision and we provide a solution, we have to deal with those consequences. God can free us and he can set us free, but there are some things in this earth we gotta deal with and deal with the aftermath of all of it. Hello? His name will be called Ishmael, which means God hears, and that he will be in constant fighting with others, and that hostility towards his brothers will be his MO. And if any good historians know, through the line of Ishmael, we get Muhammad. So what is happening right now is because of that decision that Abraham and Sarah made. We are literally fighting a war right now, brother against brother, because of a dumb decision that a husband and a wife made not to inquire of God and stick to his plan. And the world is divided and separated because of injustices that are happening on both sides. In Jesus' name, may God save Israel. In Jesus' name, may God save Jordan and Libya and Iraq and Iran and Egypt. And may every single Muslim finally claim one day that Jesus Christ is Lord. But this doesn't just happen with Agar. This happens with you and me as well. I know plenty of people who have made dumb decisions that they find Jesus, but they still have to do the prison time. I find plenty of people that they might not have done the prison time, but they had one of those accidental children that you and me have and now have to deal with the aftermath. I know people who are divorced now because they shouldn't have been together in the first place. But they were thinking of themselves rather than thinking of God, and now you have broken families and you have divorce. What do we say at the end of those vows? Till death do us part. So when divorce happens, it's supposed to be a death that we see all the time. It's supposed to be something that is dead and in the ground, and it's still up. For all of my young adults and everything like that, it is like a zombie apocalypse. We have to deal with the results. We have to deal with the solution. Now check this. But God will meet us every single step of the way. And he will be the one to give us wisdom, and he will be the one to give us understanding, and he will be the one to make it right. And there are times where we will have to say, you know what? I did it. I'm wrong. I'm sorry. And there will be no, there can't be any other thing that I can do more than that besides be the better person moving forward in God's will and God's ways. It's like Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus says, hey, I can't really do anything much with all the wrong that I've done besides pay them back. But know that I will do that and far more. And what does Jesus say? Oh, the beginning of faith has entered this house. No, he said, salvation has come to this home. Let us be reminded what it says in Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. I told you about the story of King David earlier, and I'm going to bring a conclusion to it. You know, I would normally tell you to go in your Bibles and go read it yourself, but I like you. He was confronted with that sin, the affair that he had and the murder that was on his hands by Nathan the prophet. He confessed his sin immediately when confronted, and the Lord forgave him, but not without consequence. Days later, that baby that was born to him and Bathsheba passed away. The Lord prophesied that it would happen. David prayed, he cried, he fasted, but there was nothing in his power that he could do when God had given them the word. But then this is what it says in 2 Samuel 12:24. Then David comforted his wife Bathsheba, and he went to her and made love to her, and she gave birth to a son. And they named him Solomon. God is so good that though he has told us that tragedy is going to happen, he will turn beauty into ashes. He will turn mourning into dancing. And out of a stupid decision came the wisest king that Israel had ever seen. What did I say? Passage into beauty? Oh. For those of you who are looking into the camera, the pastor does things wrong sometimes. But I got to deal with the consequences. Yeah. The Lord's solutions work out our mistakes. And some might say to me, Pastor, you don't know my mistakes, or you don't know my faults. You only know a bit of my story. You don't know my criminal record. You don't know my previous affiliations. You don't know the things that my parents had caught me up in. You don't know what I have seen. No, I have not. But I got news for you. We said it earlier today. Though your sins be as scarlet, they are now white as snow. Because our Father in heaven has forgiven you and your sins through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ. And may I remind you what it says in Ephesians 2:4. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ. Even when we were dead in our transgressions, it is by grace you have been saved. Take heart that our actions will have consequences, but our God will be ahead of us, making sure that he has the glory for everything. The Lord transforms our solutions into blessings. And the great thing that I know, and I'm going to close with this. Don't get up, though. I got a few pages. The Lord's solutions include all people. The Lord's solutions include all people. Genesis 16, verse 13. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. That is why the well was called Be'er Lahai Roy. It is still there between Kadesh and Beret. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram gave him the name Ishmael to the son she had borne him. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael. Hagar shouldn't have been a part of the plan. And I understand what happens 10 years into this mission that God gives you. Because it says that's what how long Abram was staying around. So he was 76 probably when he received that conversation and promise, and we're resuming that now. So after 10 years of attempts and going back and forth and being faithful with God, you do sometimes get careless. When you don't receive your solution immediately, you start thinking of ones yourself. We do it all the time. It happens in this church. There are plenty of times where the deacons in this church have talked to me and said, you know, Pastor, that sounds like a good idea, but is it God's idea? And now it is not my time to get puffed up. It is my time to take a back seat and say, Lord, is it really your will? I have to be just as humbled. And I have to be reminded that his solutions don't have to just come from me. They have to come from all the people of God who counsel and move forward his vision for this church. The Lord never goes back on his promise. Abram's children did increase like the stars in the skies. And this young lady who was not a part of the plan, God did not push away. The name of the well was the place that the living one has seen me. A name that talks about spiritual closeness. Musicians, if you come. The Lord loved this person so much that he sent divine help to comfort her and bring her back. To you and I, we might see this as an accident or a stumbling block in God's plan. But God doesn't do accidents, and he doesn't believe in coincidences. Everything associated with him is intentional. God is sovereign. And his conversation with Hagar was intentional because the Lord's solutions include all people. Imagine Jesus and his ministry not having the book of Luke. The book of Luke, for those of you who don't know, is the gospel to the non-Jewish people. Without the book of Luke, we wouldn't have the prodigal son. We wouldn't have the good Samaritan. We wouldn't have a gospel message that includes you and me in the family. And God in his divine wisdom had Paul and Luke get together and assemble these books so that we might have hope that God includes us with the rest of his chosen people. He loves us so much that he creates us and he forms us with natural gifts and talents and love. And in Psalm 139, starting in verse 13, it says, "For you created my innermost parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you because I am awesomely and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well." Even before you were born, before even dealing with the nature of this world, the natural sin that you were born in, God had put in you purpose, love, his own spirit and nature, his own image and his own likeness. You didn't inherit it when you said yes to Jesus. You just finally realized it for the first time fully. God wants to include all of us in that plan, but some of us have not heard the message of the Father yet. You might believe that you were an accident. that you weren't supposed to be a part of this story. Maybe your family didn't want you. Maybe you were born out of wedlock. Hello. I joke around with my parents all the time and I tell them I was their senior class gift. My mom was 17, 15 days later I was born. I'm supposed to be a statistic, people, not a pastor. I'm supposed to be 3 blocks down the road on Broadway. I'm not supposed to be here, but God. And you guys might have this story too. You might believe that you're too damaged for love, or that you have gone through the brokenness of this world, and there's only so much that God can be able to have of you. I'm here to tell you today that God only sees you as his pure child in front of him. Are you broken? Yes, by the world and the devil that doesn't want to see you prosper. But the Lord says that if you repent and call on his name, you will be clean. You might be like Hagar, running away, searching for hope, looking for solutions. And God, like the story of the prodigal son, will not wait for you to get to him. He will run to you. He loves you. He will open it up. He will be reckless and he will grab his child. And he says, come and rejoice with me, for my son or my daughter was lost, but now they are found. The question that I have for you before we respond is, will you not be afraid? He said it this morning. Will you not be afraid? Will you take courage that I will see you as you are? As the child. And that I will embrace you, not as a father of wrath that will give you punishment, but that a God who will give you love, security, faith, hope, grace. We need so much more of that rather than the wrath that this world gives us. Will you be that this morning, church? Will you do that this morning? Stand with me.